You are watching Not Just Auntie with Sumana Devapalli.
Falguni Nair, the CEO of Nykaa, founded Nykaa at the age of 50. Sheetal Bhatkar, a homemaker, feeds 2,000 families of terminally ill patients across Mumbai hospitals. And because we wanted to share these beautiful stories, we created Not Just Auntie, a channel focused on women achievers above the age of 40. Follow us on YouTube, Insta, Facebook and LinkedIn for ideas, inspiration and entertainment every Friday. Today we are going to talk to Gandhali Paranjpe. Gandhali is the younger sister of actor Sonali Bendre, but that isn't her claim to fame. She took a step back in her career as a journalist with the Times Group to nurture twin children. One of her twins was born with a congenital heart disease. Today, she has co-founded Khelomore, India's largest sports ecosystem. So let's dive right into the first interview of Not Just Auntie.
You're watching Not Just Auntie with Sumana Devapalli.
So welcome, dear Gandhali. You're the first interviewee of Not Just Auntie. And the reason I've chosen Gandhali is that we are friends who go back a long way. Gandhali and I were in the same journalism school, Xavier's Institute of Communications. We've studied journalism and mass communications together. And as luck would have it, we were selected as the first batch. I mean, for us, it was our first job. So we were selected as trainee journalists for the Indian Express. And it was and it still is a big name. So welcome to the show, Gandhali.
Thank you so much, Suman. I'm honored to be here. And I cannot tell you how excited I am that somebody's talking about women above 40 and what they can do and what they have contributed. I'm really happy about this. And my daughter is very happy too.
Okay, so I want to give a small introduction about you. So Gandhali is the co-founder and content consultant for Khelomore. Now, Khelomore is a startup aggregating young athletes and fitness enthusiasts with coaches and trainers. So Gandhali is also ex-journalist from the Times of India. She used to cover the beat of lifestyle, health and wellness. And of course, Indian Express, which we spoke about, and women's magazine Elan. Currently, Gandhali, you can be found blogging on Medium. And I will be sharing your link in the comments for the audiences. You are also a proud mother of twins, a boy and a girl, 14 years old.
Yes.
So their names, could you share their names with us?
Aditi and Dhruv.
And if you don't mind, the one question which women don't like, how old are you, Gandhali?
I'm 47.
Okay, don't look a day beyond 30.
I am about 40.
Yeah, so you're very much RTG. Two important details which I forgot to mention, which will be very exciting for our audiences, is that you are actress Sonali Bendre's sister, the very well-known and well-loved Sonali Bendre. And your husband happens to be an ex-Ranji Trophy captain, if I'm not mistaken.
Not captain, but player, yeah. Batsman, yeah.
Yeah, Jatin Paranjpe. So now over to you, Gandhali. Let's start with your career, starting from your first job.
Okay. Yeah, my first job, like you said, was Indian Express. It was a different experience altogether. We were till then, you know, sheltered college kids, you know, not doing anything much. And it was a learning experience. And that group that, well, Suman, you were there, we had that. It was a different learning experience altogether with meeting newer people, forming new bonds, forming new friendships, and understanding what the job expected of us. It was literally, I don't know why it was a job. It should have been an internship, but I don't think we had internships at that time. So yeah, that's the way it was, Indian Express. I must say one thing, that people say a lot about journalism, people say a lot about jobs, and they say, oh, they're your colleagues and, you know, it's never easy, etc. But I have made some really good friends via my first job, via my last job also, and I'm in touch with most of them.
Yeah, this interview is happening because of our friendship.
Exactly. And we have kept in touch over, of course, it's not like everyday stuff, but over a period of how many years? It's 20 years, probably.
More than that. Yeah, more than that.
And that's brilliant, you know. I mean, come on, you get friends for life from a place like that. But writing is what I really like. And moving on to my other jobs, Elan, which was a women's magazine, I don't think it's in existence anymore. But at that point of time, it was something to look forward to, something to learn from, you know, the market. Though I was editorial part, you know, but even marketing of it, you know, the colleagues would come.
Hands on.
It was all pretty much like we were a part of it. So there was a lot of learning that happened. Bylines weren't easy to come by at that time. We had to really, so even if it was response or special pages, bylines were very difficult. You had to really earn it. And doing all that, my last job, of course, was with Times of India. And I quit working because I was expecting twins. I was, of course, in my early 30s at that time. It's supposed to be not the age for women to have kids. And, you know, you've already passed your prime, et cetera, et cetera. And on top of it, it was multiple pregnancies. So I was not really, it did take a toll on me. Anybody it would have taken a toll on. So I decided I would take a step back. More importantly was that in spite of my bosses in Times of India, immediate bosses being very supportive, they were clear that if I decided to take a longer leave, they would work around keeping the job. They would probably cut my salary. They would, you know, give me unpaid leave and stuff like that. But they would still, you know, because they wanted me. But there was a little bit of a new development in my personal life at that time. Jatin, my husband, got offered a job with Nike, the apparel brand. And he had to move to Bangalore because Nike headquarters in India happened to be in Bangalore. And he was the sports marketing head for India, actually Asia Pacific. So his job was very demanding. He needed to travel a lot. If I were to move the city at that point of time with pregnancy and then having twin infants and then expecting a job back in Bombay was not really good for, I mean, it was asking for too much. So I took a step back at that time and I really wanted to concentrate on bringing up my kids at that time.
So yeah, and I think this is, if I'm not, not to sound feministic or feminist or not to sound, you know, negative, but I think this is the story of most young women, married women or expecting women. If your husband is making a move for his career, there is no option. I mean, there is no way out because, you know, it's a patriarchal society. The girl leaves her house and goes to the boy's house. And so there was no option really, as I see it.
True. No, especially because I was pregnant and with twins, you know, and moving to a new city. So had it been that I was not pregnant at that time, well, I could have continued with my job and then seen where it would have taken. Had I been staying in Bombay at that time, I had a lot of support system. Well, my in-laws, I was staying with my in-laws at that time and that was the support system that I had. But if I were to completely move to twin babies, it's not easy. Plus, which I came to know much later, of course, after my kids were born, that one of my kids, my daughter, was born with a congenital heart disease, which meant she needed to be operated at the age of 2.5 months. And then a lot of care needed to be given till she was 5, at least. She needed to be brought on her feet because that was just how it was. And well, I have no regrets at all quitting I think I was ready to also. By the time, because I had worked for almost 10 to 15 years till then. 10 years, I think, by that time.
And I just want to touch upon one point. I remember you buckling up with pain in office. I think it was not known then. You had endometriosis. I just want you to touch upon this also because I think a lot of women suffer through this and they are judged for, you know, making excuses. It's only now that there are conversations around these conditions and it is coming in the public domain. But I recall at that time that, you know, Indian Express had a very close or a very tiny team to execute a lot of publications, and one person not coming to office meant the whole load fell on the other. You were sub editor and it fell on the other girl, and it was always viewed as if, you know, oh, this lady wants a holiday on her you know, monthly cycle. So I just would request you to touch upon that a bit, if that's possible for you.
Yes. Now, that is something which it was a genuine, it was painful. It was heavy flow too. And, you know, coming from Andheri to Churchgate, or even later after I got married, from Matunga to VT, you know, when you're traveling, commuting by train, you know, the biggest problem is not really taking the leave. More so, we decide to take a leave because it's painful, you know, you need some time off, you need a couple of hours off at least to take in that pain and to get over it, and two, you, it's heavy flow, you really need a bathroom, a decent bathroom all the time, you know, that's a problem. We still don't have that great bathrooms. I don't know how offices culture is now.
No, I remember the Indian Express bathroom. It was
bathrooms are a problem.
By no way it was hygienic, and it was not equipped to handle such a large number of people.
Absolutely. In fact, I doff my hat to women who actually manage to still do freelance work, go out, get their stories, manage to do it, and through Mumbai monsoon. My first question, you know, I always wonder, how do they do it? And I'm really thankful that not everybody is as unlucky as me when it comes to period. But I always wonder how some women do it. In fact, I also wonder, this is really beyond the, it's very silly, but I always...
Not at all. Nothing is silly.
How Wonder Woman does it. You know, the way she wears those skimpy outfits and... does she never get her period, you know? But I always wonder this. I guess...
This is going to be the most catchy snippet of the whole.
But Suman, I feel that... Don't you ever wonder? Because I think because men write stories, they never ever consider this. But I'm digressing over here. But isn't this a big issue for me? I need a bathroom. And it's just a genuine problem that we live through month in, month out. And... I don't know why it is never considered. And then to imagine this with little babies, I mean, it's not easy is what I know. And I really hats off to people, women who do it. Really, their respect for them is right up there.
And now I'm going to the, you know, post 40 aspect of the conversation, as in I'm not jumping. We can go back and forth, but my question was, like, when I saw you in this state, and of course, when I had my own kids as well, the assumption, especially nuclear families, is that the mother is going to give it up all and be the primary caregiver. In your condition, it was even more delicate. It was, you know, a child who needed surgery. So the mother gives it up, and then you tell yourself that, okay, you know, I'll be with my children for a few years and then I'll get back to the job. So how has that panned out for you? And did you have that thought process? And also, I would want to add that this is possible only for women who can financially afford it. There are some women who are pitching in to pay an EMI for a flat in Mumbai. Yeah, and
absolutely.
So some of us are lucky in that sense that maybe that is not a burning need, and the woman can take some time off.
Yeah.
And, you know, the conversation she has with herself is that, you know, okay, my kids are small, especially the super unlucky ones like me who don't have support either from the in-law side or the parents are living far away. And you have to manage it in a nuclear family, and you tell yourself that, you know, it is going to get better once my kids are older. So did that happen for you?
Yeah. So I did want to get back once the kids were 5 years old. I thought that, you know, it's time they are getting into, you know, junior KG, and they don't need me as much. Of course, kids always need you, even when they are teenagers and they say, don't just get out of the room. They still need you. But, you know, the thing is that you do feel that. And And I was also encouraged from home saying that, you know, now is the time, they're five, you know, you can go out and you can be out for certain. So for me, I was really fortunate that I did get, in fact, my mother and my mother-in-law were really against me quitting my job in the first time itself.
That's fabulous. That's fabulous.
Yeah, it is. They said, you know, if people do this, you try to, don't. And it was not because we had any EMIs to pay, but it was more so because you need to be doing something for yourself. And I think that was nice. So I was again getting encouragement that, you know, hey, you know what, they are now five, you can go. I did look for jobs. I did look. But with me being a journalist, I would have to get into the same field again. And somehow over the period of 5 years, 5 to 6 years that I was out of a job, things had, maybe they were like this before too, but I never realized it. But the work day I was told the work day begins at 12.
In media companies.
Yeah, and it can go on till 8. And 9 a.m. I understand if you have to put the magazine to sleep or the paper to sleep, you have to work that late. But every single day, it was fine if that's how it works, but it wasn't going to suit me because I would never end up meeting my children because, you know, 12 o'clock, they would be back from school at that time and 8 p.m. they would be in bed. So when would I get to? And that was something I didn't want to sacrifice because, you know, seeing children and growing, you know, bringing them up is another different pleasure. And I really wanted to do that. I had my children because I wanted them, not because somebody Absolutely. Told me to have children.
Of course.
And, you know, so it was all my, in fact, if I would have said I don't want kids, that was fine too. So when I bring them into this world, my thought was that I need to give them certain nourishment. And that was where
and nurturing.
Absolutely. And that's where I came from. So I was not ready to see the point is, Suman, that I would have done what I could have done had I really needed to do it, had I required that kind of money, but it would have been very stressful. And, you know, today when we sit back, we think, oh, money was good, but was the stress worth it?
Yes.
At the same time, I would say, oh, you know what? I had a good life with children, but I could have earned so much more. And, you know, it's always going to be that kind of a thing. I do not regret a single decision that I have made. And I never tell my children that, you know what, because if you had to quit work, because that's not what they didn't tell me to do all that. And I'm happy.
And you don't feel resentful.
I do not feel. I am happy, in fact, because I think it opened up my mind to various things, various ideas, various possibilities. And with Khelo More happening, yeah, it's Jatin's dream, of course. You know, Jatin is a sports person. He wants to do something for sports. But anything that requires content cannot be that I'm not involved. I understand zero of sports. But content, language, I understand. Because content is my field. And that's about it. And I'm enjoying doing that at the same time. I have found a lot of pleasure in building myself, building my own body and mind. And I got into fitness big time.
In fact, I was just waiting to come to that question because this is something that a lot of people will want to learn from you and know more about. So Gandhali is, I think I have known her since 22 or 23 years, and she was going to the gym even at that time when, you know, regular gym memberships were not even known by lay people like us, middle-class families, but she had a gym membership and she used to go every day, I think before or after office. And we were like, wow, you know, is it because she's a celebrity sister and, you know, those kind of things. And I just recall you being super fit, you know, through office, through your, I mean, your wedding ceremonies, of course, you know, we all look our best, we try to. And even after childbirth, I mean, no one would say that this lady has delivered twins. And you have maintained that journey. You have started blogging on Medium. I have read your blogs and they are very, very informative. They are very, very simple to follow.
Fitness is, like you said, I've always been into it. I've always enjoyed it. Now the difference is that I have gotten big time into weight training and strength training, and I really think it's it's the thing for women to do. It's not about losing weight, it's about being fit. And there are basic things that, you know, you are not able to do as you grow older, having carried children within. You know, we are, our backs, our core, our glutes are gone, and that is leading up to arthritis problems, you know, backaches in the future, and, you know, not being able to sit down, get up, and basic things which, you know, we used to take for granted in the 20s. So I decided that, okay, you know what, right now, since I'm not working, since I'm not doing much, let me, when we have family holidays where my kids who are growing up, and my son is pretty boisterous and pretty adventurous, and he wants to do certain things like maybe trekking or paragliding. We've not done it so far because the lockdown has happened and yes, stuff like that. But, you know, there are various degrees of things that you can do with your kids. I said, I don't want to be the ones being the kacha nimbu and there in the back saying, oh, you guys go ahead, I'll
be holding the bags.
I didn't want to be, I wanted to be right there with my kids and my husband having fun. So, yeah, you know, that was actually my motivation to really get fitter. And I did it, and I'm still doing it. And it's an addiction, really. And I think this is a better addiction than anything else.
Yeah. But and I remember you saying that you just feel happy after going
How happy. And it also, I'm not kidding you, working on your body in a disciplined manner really works on your mind. You know, we tend to have so many issues. We are judgmental, we are angry, we are stressed out, we are unhappy. You know, we just learn to be happy and content by when we start taking care of our body. We do not have to look like Miss India. Everybody has a different body type. So I'm really the wrong one to say that, because I do see myself and I say, okay, I'm slim and I'm fit, and hey, you know what, people would want to be like me. But with utter humility, let me say that everybody is different and everybody has a different way of dealing with their fitness. As long as one is fit, that's it.
And able to do the activities they want.
Absolutely, absolutely. There is no need to be an hourglass figure and Miss India type or whatever that type is. In fact, that's the most unhealthy type. I also realized that food is very important. Not just eating out, but food and what you eat is very important. And recently I started becoming more and more of, I want to eat organic, home-cooked, homemade, Indian food than processed food. So my journey is into that.
Okay. The question is that whenever we saw you in college and we saw that, you know, you're fit and you're slim and you're good looking and you're healthy and, you know, you have glowing skin, we always thought, I mean, and this is, I was told when I didn't even know who Gandhali Bendre is. So I was told, ki, yeah, she is this celebrity sister and, you know, she is thin because her jeans are thin. Like, look at her sister and, you know, they don't need to do anything. So what would you want to say about this?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, Suman, I get what you are saying. But, you know, maybe at a certain age, it was true that I was genetically predisposed. But today, I have to work hard towards my fitness, towards being healthy. And it has got nothing to do with the fact that I'm Sonali Bendre's sister. Hell, even she has to do it now. And we all know the story that she's gone through. So even she needs to take care of herself in a certain way to not fall back upon having any issues. So I think I work really hard to look the way I do. It's not easy at all.
So, yeah, and I think we've all learned this from you, seeing you through the last 2 decades, that you know, there is no inheritance when it comes to health. You have to work at it. There's no shortcut.
Whether it's fitness, whether it's money, whether it is anything.
And in fact, I just wrote about this yesterday. You know, like, I had done a diploma in yoga, and I used to practice yoga only when I just felt that, you know, oh, I'm feeling some stiffness. I was never consistent. I think one thing that I've learned from all the experts in the field and people who have succeeded in maintaining their bodies the way they like is consistency. You have to work at it every day.
Every day. And what you do when you're not working out is also of equal importance. What you eat, how you sleep. I don't go partying like crazy. Of course, 2020, we have not been able to. But yeah. Apparently, there is an impression that, oh, you know what? She parties like hell. But that's not the fact. And I do follow a routine and I do take care of.
In fact, Gandhali, tell me about your routine as a friend who's been in touch for many years. I didn't know you wake up so early. So can you just outline your routine for the rest of us and about your cat?
I'm a laughing stock of my family and my friends, you included. They say, why do you get up at 5 a.m.? I'm like, well, I like to get up. I get time to myself. I love drinking coffee when the house is quiet, when there is nobody saying, you know, what is to be made for lunch today? What are your plans for the day? Mama, what's this? Mama, I want this. I really like that 1.5 hour of quiet that I get to think, to read up. And I honestly, I'm telling you, I like reading, but during the day, it becomes so difficult to pick up a book or even read an article without getting disturbed like some 4 times at least. And I might probably be reading the same line over and over and I am disturbed. Abhi, bhabhi abhi khana kya banana hai? Bhabhi abhi wo aaya hai? You know, it's just there. And so I catch up on my reading. I catch up on emails at that time. I drink my coffee, which is again a joke, and I work out, yes.
So how do you catch up on your sleep is something which I think everyone would want to know.
I do. I am not a superwoman. I do not claim to be. I catch a nap, whether it's 15 minutes, usually it's 15 minutes in the afternoon. And I also sleep pretty early. By 10:30 p.m. I'm ready to call it a day. So weekends are a time I keep for late nights. You know, we have a late night movie or meeting friends or something, which is weekends usually because I sleep in later.
Can you touch upon your diet if that's possible and how it has changed from your 20s to what it is today?
Okay, that's easy. Number one and first and foremost, I don't have any nutritionist that I follow. And whatever I say, Suman, please put a disclaimer over there. This is what I tried for myself and this is what has worked for myself. I don't say that everybody has to follow what I'm saying. This is what works. It's not like that. I have learned over a period of years that each person has a different kind of body structure, body type. In Ayurveda, you do call it
Vata Pitta Kapha.
I am again not an expert in this, so I'm not going to say, I'm only going to talk what works for me. And the only good thing that I had in me right from beginning was that my mother never encouraged us to have various meal between meals because Mom was the only person in the house doing a lot of things for us. And I don't think she had the patience to constantly keep giving us some snacks or the other. And so she said, please have your meals properly at one time and don't come 15 minutes later. You're not gonna which my son doesn't do right now. And that's somewhere. But I do, I think that was a very nice thing that my mom instilled into us. And when you sit for your proper meals at that point of time, eat properly. Whatever you're eating, whatever is our home cooked meal, eat it well. Eat it with full concentration. And like you asked me, what has changed from 20s to 40s? There's a big difference. While I was a teenager and in my 20s, Suman, I used to eat. I didn't look like that, but I used to eat. And we used to go out and eat that horrible Chinese also, I remember. But Road ka khana. We can still do it and I can still do it. But when we are in 20s, our metabolism is at a different level altogether. But now in our 40s, if we start eating like the way we used to eat in our 20s, then we are going to have pot bellies and we're never going to lose weight and we're going to have all kinds of issues with our internal system. Because as we are growing older, our bodies are telling us that, hey, cut down. So maybe at that time we were eating 6 meals a day and whatever, but now I have just 2 meals a day.
Okay.
I intermittently fast. I have fast for 16 hours. I do not have breakfast. I straight go to lunch, but my lunch is king's lunch. Proper, I sit for half an hour. I eat it well, complete with protein. And I focus a lot on protein. So whether it's vegetarian protein or non-vegetarian protein, I focus a lot on that. I, over a period of few years, I discovered that I kind of do not go well with wheat. I don't have bread at all. Refined flour, refined sugar is completely out of my diet. But I do not go in for atta either. So suji or atta, I have completely cut out of my life. And I have gone back to what our ancestors would have in the villages, which is known as villages. Garibon ka khana, probably bhakri with, you know, nachni bhakri or jawar. You know, those are the rotis that I have with vegetables, good amount of vegetables and sprouts and dal, chawal. That's my meal and that's about it. And I have good proper meal twice a day. So lunch and dinner.
And is there a ratio of like what you have in your plate? Would you like to share something on, or if it's there in a blog, it's okay because we can't cover everything in the interview itself.
I don't think so much about
okay.
it. As long as it is, you know, frankly, Suman, if we go back to our roots and if we go back to what villagers eat, you know, I think that is the secret to remaining fit and healthy. Because over a period of time, we city people have started eating really bakwas. In the name of, I don't know what all, we really...
Fast food.
And even if it is home cooked, it is just not... I don't know. If we really start digging into it, and that could be a topic for something else, but how, is wheat really a part of our culture as much? Because if you really go to see our, you know, villages, Gehu was not as big. I'm Maharashtrian. I don't know how big Gehu was.
It's from the north.
It's from the north. And I see a lot of my North Indian friends not able to live without roti, but it's easier for us to give up for me. So I get there is some kind of a genetic, ethnic...
Predisposition
here. So just follow what your culture or ethnicity asks for, basically. And just eat that. No need to listen to 10,000 people and follow this diet and that diet and blah, and blah, is what I feel.
Could you talk more about your work and, you know, what Kelomo does? And if someone wants to know more about the company, if you could touch upon that. Could.
I'll tell you, Kelomo actually also was born out of a very... it's an interesting story. We were living in Hilversum, Amsterdam for a couple of years because Jatin was handling European football at that time. And Netherlands has a very nice sport culture in their country. All little children are encouraged to play sports and they have a completely kind of a uniform system wherein your five-year-olds will go and play. This is how they will start off with football or tennis or hockey or whatever. Girls, boys, it didn't matter. They had to, the age group mattered. That's about it. And I would see people over there come snow, and you know, the winters are crazy.
Yeah.
People would be jogging, they would be playing sports. And as the kids got older, their timing of the amount of time they gave for sports increased and it was allowed. The schools encouraged that, the government encouraged that. Swimming was compulsory, you know, swimming lessons from a certain age were compulsory for children and they were taught swimming in a certain uniform way again. You know, we were really impressed by that. And being a sports person, Jatin kept saying, you know, why don't we have something like this? You know, we have viewership. People are passionate about sports in India, but only to look, to see. Why can't they just participate? And, you know, that's where his sportsman, Jen Jeans came into. He said, I want to do this. I want to do something. And coming back here, we realized getting coaches, even for our own kids, was a little difficult in spite of having sports background. So he said, there are coaches sitting free. They don't know that these certain academies do not have coaches and academies are sitting free. They don't know there are good coaches available. Why don't we just get them together? That was the basic idea behind it. But it's
fabulous.
It's grown so much. Now we booked turfs. Now we organize events, sporting events. Now we, with the lockdown, we did lockdown mein khelo more, wherein, you know, online coaching sessions were happening. Now we have started khelo more at home, wherein like how you Swiggy food, you could just book a coach to come home. And the coach comes on a bike with all his equipment, nets, turf, whatever, folded up. And he lays it out for you, what if 45 minutes to an hour, whatever your session that you've paid for, he comes, he coaches you, your child, whoever, and then goes back. So we have that system working.
Wow, I didn't know about this model myself. I mean, I had no idea. So this is great information.
Yes, and we have now branched out. We have, because we have so much demand over the lockdown, we have ballet, we have contemporary dance, we have Zumba, we have yoga, we have fitness trainers, we have a lot.
Wow. Okay, fabulous. In fact, our scriptures say that, you know, do your dharma and you will be taken care of. So I think as a mother, being with your kids, you know, when they needed you, when they were vulnerable, when, of course, when Aditi was getting operated. So I think you took that chance of, you know, giving up on your career at that time. And today you're in a good place.
Yeah.
But I just want you to highlight, you know, the pros and cons of working with your spouse and how you feel in terms of your career at 47. And also that what if, sorry, I'm bunching two, three questions. Like what if you weren't doing something with Jatin? Like would the market be welcoming towards you, the job market?
Okay. So first and foremost, working with spouses, it's got its own big challenges. You know, you just never get a break because there is office and then there is home and it's all intermingling into it. And, you know, you're looking into a lot of things and you're looking into each other's things also. And it's kind of, but you just have to be really careful about, you know, letting them do what they're doing and, you know, me doing. So it was pretty much okay. I'm doing my content. But yeah, you suggest because I'm not a sports person. So you tell me what is it. But over and above that, this is what will go in. And over and above that, let me be very honest. This is Jatin's vision. This is Jatin's baby. And he really has a passion for this. And that passion is something which I would really not want to touch upon. In not touch upon, but
interfere?
Something which I wouldn't interfere. Because he knows and he really has a nose for it. And he knows what he's talking about. He knows what he's doing. And he is coming from a really good space with this. He really wants to do it out there for Indian sports. And that in itself is it's something which he understands best. Your second question was about if I was not with Khelo More, I don't think the industry would have been so good at taking me back unless I would have brought something bigger to the table. As in probably put in, gotten my ideas, my contacts, and then gotten on an equal footing with somebody else, because it would have been very difficult. I would have had to do some freelancing jobs, or jobs here, or jobs there. A 9-to-5 job would have been very taxing and demanding because I would have had to prove myself doubly. Firstly, as a woman. Secondly, as somebody who's come back again. And the world has changed. People who have been in the field, they might not feel that the world has changed a lot, but when I have taken a gap and I see a writing, the language has changed, the medium has changed, everything has changed, and it's very difficult to understand that and to understand what the youngsters are talking about. I do not understand social media as much. I do not understand. You have to have this handle, you have to have this hashtag. I fail in that miserably. I would have struggled a lot at that point. I'm sure I would have done it because we're not quitters, but I'm happy where I am. I started writing blogs now. I would have started writing it a few years ago, probably.
Like today, the pandemic has actually changed the world.
at large, I mean, everywhere, I think people are more open to gigs and, you know, freelancers or remote workers. But it was not true when, say, we had our kids. Even now, do you think that there is respect for a person who has taken such a big gap, especially a lady? I think we're talking about ladies here, more or less. Definitely, there are men who need to take a break for personal reasons, but it's more often the women. And do you think even the freelance market is welcoming, or does it respect women who have taken a career break for whatever legitimate reason?
See, it's always going to be a legitimate reason in our country. We're not in the US where we say I'm taking a sabbatical or whatever. But, you know, I'm really not sure I'm a good, right person to answer this, because I've not gone extensively looking for a job either. When I knew that that the working hours are not good, and sending out feelers to whatever contacts I have, and I have a lot of friends still working, yeah. You know, whatever I've heard from them, I've not been too keen. So I don't know if I'm a right person to answer the corporate space kind of a question, because I've not gone so much to inquire about it. And about respect in corporate space, again, I wouldn't know, because I haven't encountered so many people. But if you talk about respect in terms of anybody else around me, you know, talking to me about who are you and what are you doing, and do they respect me more for being something? That's our society, Suman. They want to know what you're doing because they want to know how much respect they can give you, basically. So you, what do you do? I'm a stay-at-home mom. Oh, you're a stay-at-home mom. It's how it is. So,
lose brownie points for saying that?
Yeah, but I would wear it as a badge of honor, because, hey, I'm a stay-at-home mom. When I was capable of doing so many things, I chose to do this. And I'm bringing forward to really good citizens of India tomorrow. And why is that supposed to be, oh, you're a stay-at-home mom? I do have options. I am equal to my husband. We are partners. We are not, it's not like he told me to quit. It was a conscious Absolutely. Choice that I took. So if anybody thinks less of me because of that, it's their problem. Very honestly, I'm very happy in this space. I'm looking forward to every day. I don't have a reason to crib and complain about anything. And isn't that a beautiful space to
be? Of course. Coming back, like, now your kids are teenagers and they don't really need you hands-on. I mean, of course, we all would like to supervise, but we don't need to be helicopter moms. And, you know, we have all the space and the bandwidth to go back to work. So, what have you worked with women of your age group, and how do you feel your age helps you be a better person or a better worker at Khelo More, if you could touch upon that?
Okay. I have, in Khelo More itself, when we started off, we had really few, very few women. We had very few staff, actually, per se. And mostly we were looking at younger crowd, because it's a tech company. And you know what? My women my age are not into
tech savvy.
Not tech savvy. They have not, you know, it's a completely different ballgame altogether. The what do you call the techies, you know? They are youngsters there. I am they are the young millennials. They are not my generation. Absolutely. So when we talk of digital marketing again, we are having younger crowd over there, because again, that's the crowd that understands what it is. In spite of that, we do have a few women my age, either handling the call center part or either handling the... see, we also had an apparel for children. We had started, which has temporarily been shut because of the pandemic. We called it 321. So we had our own designer, who was also an ex-Nike. She was my age. She was a little younger than me. Not my age. It's unfair to call her. She is below 40. It's really unfair to call her my age.
No problem.
But she was an experienced person, and she really knew how to, what apparel business was, what retail business was. and there she was. So it depends on what we're looking at and what field it is. When it comes to sports per se, Suman, I don't see a lot of my age women getting involved or wanting to apply also for it. A lot of younger women, yes. A lot of older men, yes.
Or is it just assumed that there won't be roles for them?
Because we have been giving out
job profiles
on LinkedIn, etc. And it's an open thing. In fact, I know that when you're looking for office space, every time Jatin and I would go and I said, okay, the only thing I want is there a good toilet space? I need women to be able to feel safe and have a good toilet space. So, you know, and he was like, you're just gone. I said, no, that's very important for women. So
because it's been your experience.
Yes. And you know, we do have girls. It's just that they tend to be younger lot. I don't understand sports as much. I may be an exception, not the rule, but so many of my friends they would read it, but they wouldn't follow sports like how their husbands or sons follow.
True. What do you feel is the advantage of your age in whatever you're doing right now? Like, does it help you in any way, or you just feel like you're just here because you're here and that's it?
My age helps me in a lot of things. Well, we are at our age because we have gone through a lot of experiences in life and they shape us. So, I feel that at my age, I have learned quite a few things. I have learned how to be more diplomatic. I have learned to be more adjusting to people and accommodating and being less judgmental. I think when I was in 20s, I wasn't half as good as I am now, probably. But yeah, that's what comes with age. And I think that's what I bring to the table.
The table.
Anytime, whether it's Kelomore or it's home or wherever. So we do grow up with our age. I think it's a beautiful age to be in.
Yes, absolutely. I agree. And the whole concept of not just auntie is this.
It's so such a wonderful thing. You just said it, you know. And when I was telling my daughter this, she said, yeah, why did they say auntie like that? You know, it's something not nice. So I said, yeah, it's supposed to be derogatory.
Oh, yeah, it is. And in fact, I remember that I became auntie. I used to meet my fiance who's now my husband, and when I used to go to his building, I was like the kids just hi didi. And the day I got married, I came as a bride, I became hi auntie. Okay. And then I was totally written off the day I had my first child. And I think, you know, these kind of psychological levels are created when it comes to women and when it comes to women at work. And so I was just speaking to in fact, I don't want to name her, but our common friend who heads recruitment, so she was just telling me that she has been given these mandates from companies, big brands in India, that they don't want women above 30. So,
I know why.
Tell me.
Women above 30 are much more stronger in their convictions. They are not babe in the woods. They're not green behind the ears. They know how to negotiate. They know what they want. And they're not shy of asking what they want. And a lot of times people don't want to deal with that. They don't want to deal with a strong woman. And women from their 30s onwards, 35 especially, they come into their own. They start becoming stronger. And not everybody can
handle. And speak their mind.
They speak their minds and they want what they want. And they're right, and they can put, and they negotiate for their prices. You know, younger girls don't. And but I feel that, you know, the same situation, you would give it to a man, but why not a woman? And then you come up with excuses like, oh, you know what, she will have kids or she'll get married. And then, you know, you never think about these things for men. And, you know, if I had to do it, Suman, I know, by God, I know that I would have done a good job at my work and with my children and killed myself doing it. That's besides the point, but I would have done it. Just because we women want to prove, and we are all the time wanting to prove, you know, that I'm as good as the man next to me. And that is so unfair. And this is the reason why people say we do not want older women.
No, and just to dwell on a point which you said that, you know, during recruitment, they think, if this is her age, then she's going to take a break and she's going to have kids after 2 or 3 years. And I have had this question, like when I took a maternity break for 2 years, which included part of my pregnancy. And I took a break till my child was one. And I was asked by many HR officers that why is this gap there in your resume? And why didn't you come back after 3 months? My question is that is a child really ready to be left at
three months
of age when actually, you know, all Indian doctors suggest that the mother has to be exclusively breastfeeding for 6 months. Not only, again, I don't want this to become a feminist conversation because this channel is not about, feminism or feminist rights only. Of course, there will be some of it, some percentage of it. But my question is, if the women don't take a break and nurture the children, who's going to do it? You know,
exactly.
If you want both of them on the desk throughout the 30, 35 years of their career that they're going to be active, who is going to have the children and who is going to raise the children?
Exactly. So. And Suman, in Hilversum, I used to see that, you know, there was to be for mothers. I mean, you could opt out for a 4.5 working day week. You could take a Wednesday off or something other than your Saturday and Sunday. And, you know, there were certain hours that they gave you. So, plus, the schooling was so uniform that, you know, the schools would end at 3:15, all the schools. So, you know, the mother wanting to be home from 4 p.m. onwards was allowed. She would be allowed to log in from home. You know, there were certain rules and regulations, but they were allowed to follow. And men were also given certain amount of paternity leave. So you could take that those days off and your wife could, you know, you and your wife could adjust it. We don't have this system in our country. And our HR ministers also do not talk about this. When you talk about it, they will talk about villages and rural areas and, you know, not so privileged women and everything. But you know what? We are also not that privileged, actually, when we come to think of it. And if you just made this thing, if you would have just made a provision in, say, a place like Times of India, which is a big company, to have a crèche over there, how bad would it be? I mean, women would work. You just try to organize that for women. Have a crèche. Can't you do that? Once the child starts going to school, yeah, it's a different thing. But when it's a baby, then Suman, you wouldn't have taken a 3-year break. You would have come back after 3 months. You would have got your little baby along probably. Wouldn't you have worked then?
Of course I would have.
This is not rocket science, but it is not thought of. But men were to go through this, we would have been, everything would have been laid out on platter for them. If men were to have periods, everything would be the ultimate. But it's not women.
Yeah. Nobody and like you said, the men are the ones who are planning. So yes, they would have considered it. Yes.
And
I get that.
Women raise their voice till women come out and say that this is not done. You know, men are going to say, "Wo to chalta hai, chalne do." I remember a friend of mine telling me few years ago that women do not negotiate, and that is why what you're saying is that, you know, above 30 they don't want, because when women start negotiating they are just
above 30
they are not malleable probably.
Yeah, they don't fit into the culture of
absolutely. I mean, just look what you're doing to the society per se, you know. I mean, what kind of world is this? And I just don't know. It's really weird if you come to think of it.
Like for women to feel compelled to leave their small kids and go to work, is that what you're saying?
That number one. Number two, to not give. I mean, where is the equal opportunity here? Where is it? When we really talk about it. Then you say, okay, are you going to take a 4.5 day work week? Then this is the salary for it. And that other, whatever one day that you're taking, you're going to be working from home. These are the login timings. You have to log in and you have to log off. And that's how you have to do it. So, you know, I mean, have rules in place. And now with the pandemic, we have learned that this can happen. Work from home is possible. So I hope somebody out there notices and starts making these changes. We can only talk about it here.
You're watching Not Just Auntie with Sumana Deepali.